There was a night before I went to Iowa that I was with my partner at the time, my boyfriend, and I just kind of thought to myself, like, later on that night, like it was my moment of like saying it out loud to myself. It was like a growing voice. I was in New York, I was seeing queer couples all around me, and I started to like kind of feel this little bit of jealousy a bit. Or like I would look at them and like feel something and I couldn't identify it. And then I kept like kind of putting this voice down. And then it was the night before I went to Iowa, and I thought to myself, like, you're, and it was a moment that I said it out like out loud in my head. I say that like, you're gay. And the moment that I said that, it felt kind of like this flood of just like all of the wind taken out of me in this like really like weighty type of way, where all of this weight was taken off of me, and it clicked. The same way that I felt later on when I said you don't want to be in journalism anymore, that you want to move to Tel Aviv, like these, it was a similar type of feeling.
Hello, beautiful people. Yes, I am talking to you. Are you ready to feel confident AF, free from the expectations and opinions of others, and create ultimate self-trust in who you are, what you say, and how you show up in every part of your life? If you answered a hell yes, I am, I guarantee this episode will empower you to be 100% yourself, 100% of the time, no shame or guilt needed. It's time for you to strut your stuff, express yourself with freedom, and fully embrace every freaking fabulous part of you. Let's dive in. Hello, my beautiful friends, and welcome to another episode of Road to Radical Visibility. My name is Rachel Freeman Sowers, also known as the Break Free Bitch, because I am passionate about helping people in the LGBTQ plus and female communities break free from the toxic social constructs, opinions, expectations, and beliefs that have been holding them back from experiencing their life exactly the way that they want to. And if you've hung out here for very long, you'll know that my professional and my personal motto is being 100% yourself, 100% of the time, no shame or guilt needed. And today's guest, oh, I just cannot wait. I have just this excitement kind of rolling around in my chest, and this is the first time she's hearing this, so I'm just going for it. But I feel like it's going to be a whole different perspective than what we've ever brought to the show before, so I can't wait to get this conversation started. But before I go ahead and do that, let me read her bio to you. My guest today is Kendall. She is a Philadelphia native who moved 5 years ago to live with her wife in Tel Aviv. And after working as a political journalist covering U.S. national politics, thank you so much. That has to be difficult for places like Bloomberg and NBC. She now works as a community manager at Riverside.fm, which is the platform we are using to record this and that I use to record all of the Road to Radical Visibility. If you don't use it yet, you should be using Riverside.fm. Okay, so I met Kendall through Riverside. She actually asked to highlight me in the month of June for Pride Month. And I was like, hell yes, that is always a hell yes. Help me welcome Kendall to the show. Kendall, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having me. I've been really looking forward to having this conversation since we originally started talking. So yeah, happy to be here.
It was almost an automatic connection for me. I don't, it might not have been for you, but like, it was like,
oh,
we
no,
had
same.
Just this energy. It was really great.
Yeah, I and completely agree. No, it was, the feeling was mutual. Don't worry.
Okay. So the first question I ask every single guest on the show is, what does radical visibility mean to you?
Yeah, no, so I think that's a really great question. I've been thinking about that a lot, and I don't know if I exactly know the definition of it. I mean, I think to me, it's about being radically yourself. Mm. It's about being radically yourself in front of other people. I think the hardest part of radical visibility is actually being radically visible to yourself, if I'm being completely honest, kind of admitting to yourself how you actually feel and kind of saying that out loud in your head, if that makes any sense. And then projecting that and having kind of the courage, the bravery, the acceptance in yourself to project that outwardly to other people. if that makes sense.
It makes total sense. And I love that so much. You were probably the first guest so far that has said this piece about being radically visible to yourself. And that really is the most courageous and brave part of radical visibility, because it can be difficult to look into those depths and those deep parts of you that you've been taught to shame or be guilty of, you know, or for, you know?
Exactly. No, and I actually think that when I think about times where I was radically visible to, like, in life, I think really the hardest step for me, it was when I was thinking about this podcast, it's just the hardest step for me was always kind of like coming out to myself in a way, admitting to myself that it's how I feel, because I think that we work ourselves up, that we feel a certain way. And then it's really about, once you admit it to yourself that you feel a certain way, at least for me, I think that that's when the visibility starts, because then you see it. There's a click that kind of happens, at least for me, and in kind of my mind. And it leads to me being able to be radically visible to other people.
Yeah, I love that click that happens in your mind. Also knowing that that click happens in the heart at the same time, that's how I've experienced it. And my clients, it's like, it's almost like now there's no, they reach the point where what they were craving and how they wanted to interact in the world is actually how they're interacting. And it comes from such that deeper place, but it's often the mind that will stop us from toxic social constructs, beliefs, opinions, and expectations that have been given to us that are never ours in the first place.
Yeah, absolutely. And I have like experience with that as far as with work. I've experienced that with my own coming out story. I've experienced that with my moving. They all included these moments that I just had to sit down with myself and first admit it in my head before I was able to really move forward. And I found that that was also the hardest part, because it was, once that happened, it was just easier to talk to people about it.
Well, so we were talking a little bit before the show about being a journalist. You said you were a journalist in 2016. I can't imagine what that was like. And if we're talking about it in the concept of radical visibility, I mean, everyone in the US was kind of freaking the fuck out. I mean, let's just be completely honest about things that were happening on both sides, whatever sides that was, right? Everyone was in this chaos. Here you are, a journalist. And how, like, what was that experience like for you?
Yeah.
that says it all, everyone. If you're not watching the video, you should go check out the video. Minute, 6 minutes, 10 seconds. Look at Kendall's face. That will explain it all.
Yeah, so, I mean, it was really interesting for a lot of reasons. So, 2016, I was covering the, what ended up being the Trump presidential election, but I was covering for Bloomberg all of the presidential candidates at the time, and there still is also a Showtime show called The Circus. I was working with the hosts of that, and it was a lot about behind the scenes of the presidential campaign. So, I got to have a really cool behind the scenes look at every presidential campaign, whereas a lot of the time you only get kind of one candidate. So when I was doing that, that also coincided with me coming out. So there was a lot going on in the 2016 campaign, a lot happening. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. I constantly joke that, if I were to ever write a book, there would have to be the time where I came out to myself while I was in Iowa, because like that was just interesting. So we'll get to that story, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But so basically I'm coming out, I'm covering the 2016 presidential campaign, and being a journalist is kind of like, in a way, like the opposite in my mind of like radical visibility. You're really just there to tell other people's stories, to hear other people's stories. So like if I had an opinion, I'm really like, as far as journalism, really an old school kind of journalist, in the way that I think that there are too many opinions stated, that I think that it doesn't let people form their own opinion. So I was really of the mindset of, I want to listen to these stories and I want to get the story out of it. Like if people are ignoring some of the more salacious things that Trump is saying, why is that? What is driving them to vote this way? And that's the story. Like, is it economics? Is it that these people haven't gotten a pay raise in years? Like trying to get those stories out. And to be a journalist for me was really about being invisible in a way. Like, I'm not supposed to say my opinion. I'm not supposed to agree, disagree. So it was really observing. And I think that that was difficult at times, but actually made me see things clearer at other times where it didn't feel like there was one side against another. It was just being able to see people for their struggles, their needs, their wants. So that was, but then also, of course, it's always hard to be interviewing somebody and kind of have to nod your head as they're saying something that could be disparaging to you, could kind of trigger you in some way. And you just, it's your job to just stand there and then communicate that story and almost pass that story on, and how beneficial is a story to be passed on? How damaging could the story be to pass on? Those kind of things. So it was kind of a, in that way, a practice of like radical invisibility.
It makes total sense. And like, oh my gosh, as you're speaking, I was like, I won't say never, because I was in those positions, not as a journalist, but as a therapist for sure, where you're just sitting there nodding, you're listening to their story, you're listening to all their beliefs about possibly you and who you are, where you come from, how you live your life, you know, being a part of a marginalized community. And that was like the hardest part for me, was like, I can't stand by and just do this thing anymore. I don't want to keep my mouth shut about things anymore.
It was difficult.
I just can't fathom doing that now. So how did you leave? What made you leave? I mean, what's the story behind not going from a journalist to now being a community manager at Riverside.fm?
Yeah, so actually it's funny, because then that's another story of radical visibility. So this is all happening. I'm in journalism. I ended up moving from after the 2016 election wrapped up. That was kind of the end of the show that I was working on with Bloomberg. And then I moved over to MSNBC. I was working with a few shows there. And there was this kind of, like, I liked what I was doing, but I was realizing that to be in this world was like, you have to completely throw yourself at this world. It was a 24/7 job. And the more that I was getting into it, the more that I was realizing that that's maybe not where my heart was. At the same time, I actually went on a trip. I went on a trip to Israel, and two of my friends have kind of like convinced me to go. I hadn't wanted to go. And they're like, no, we're going to do it together. So we ended up going. And I met somebody there. That somebody is now my wife, the reason that I moved to Tel Aviv. So we had met around the time, during the time that I was at NBC, and I had gone to visit her. She had come to visit me. And it was just slowly becoming apparent to me that that's kind of, I was young, I didn't own anything. It was kind of like a moment of, I've made these connections in politics that I can go try this out. And if I didn't like it, I could always come back. But when I say that there was part of my road to radical visibility, it's because I'd really in my head kind of chalked up this idea that you're a political journalist in the age of Trump. Trump was just elected. And you get all the time, especially you're at NBC, you're at like a bigger name place. You get all the time people saying like, wow, that's so cool that you're doing that. That's amazing that you're doing that. And I started to realize that like, it wasn't that I was so happy in doing that. Mm-hmm. It's that I really liked how I appeared in other people's eyes, you know, how my job appeared in other people's eyes. And yeah. And so I think that it drove me. It was like, I'm a political journalist. I'm working for NBC. It's the biggest story in the world right now, and I'm covering it. And that is incredibly cool. But I think that that kept me there for a little bit longer than I was happy, just because I was so excited about that fact. So then there was another moment of visibility to me where I looked in myself and said, are you happy? And then I also had to look at myself and say, what would make you happy? And the idea of moving to this side of the world like quitting my job to be with kind of like, I mean, we'd been long distance for like a year, but kind of somebody that I barely really knew in like such a, like in the way that I know her now, it was this kind of admitting to myself that like, am I going to drop this thing that that everyone around me has kind of built up to be so exciting and cool, which it was, for something that I found really exciting and cool, but also might have seemed a little bit crazy to other people to just like drop your job and do that. And so that was another moment where I kind of said in my own head, when I say about coming out with these with these ideas in your to yourself, it wasn't until I said to myself, like, you want to move, like you want to do this, stop and just do it, that I kind of moved. And then from there, I started working in content. I couldn't work in political journalism here because I don't know the language and I didn't know enough about the politics at that time. So it wasn't something that I wanted to get into. And then I realized that what I loved about journalism was taking those stories and meeting the people and going around and talking to people. And I really loved the community, like meeting communities. So when Riverside approached me about a community job, it was something I'd never thought of, but realized that that's actually something that really makes me excited.
Well, I know so many.
That's my long-winded answer.
Well, it's a great answer because I know so many of my community and whoever listens to this podcast is going to see themselves in you in that moment when, oh, I've arrived. I'm doing this thing that I have always thought I've wanted to do. And it has prestige, right? It has these things. And everyone's like, congratulations. Like, great job. You have like this perfect thing. What a great, and yes, you can like doing that. And at the same time, noticing how at times we're such intention with ourselves internally because we want more or we want something different. And people are looking at you like, why would you give this up? I've had so many more people that I've been able to work with and meet in Washington, D.C., and that has got to be one of the hardest places to say, this is not what I want to do, especially if you're in a political realm, because everything there is like high pressure from what I can gather from my clients who talk about, this is what I'm supposed to love doing. I've reached this spot in Washington, D.C., and I mean, we're talking foreign diplomats and everything, and they're like, I'm here and I don't want, yes, I'm grateful. And at the same time, it's not feeding my soul. Like, it's not doing what I want to do and following my own heart.
Yeah. And you're surrounded by people that it is feeding their soul. Like, there are some people that are really born for that. And then they're, and so to kind of look around, it's kind of like, yeah, we're all excited to be here, right? It's like, it's that kind of feeling that you're like, yeah, I'm definitely excited to be here. And so it's kind of admitting to yourself, like, maybe I'm not. It's kind of, it's scary to like say to yourself, like, am I happy? You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, okay. So you mentioned a little bit earlier in the show, you're covering all this stuff, 2016 presidential election, you're telling these stories, you're, seeing disparities, all the while you mentioned that this is also the time that you came out. Like, how did I want to do this with my fingers. And if you're listening to the podcast, I'm just intermingling them because it's like all of this is at an intersection.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you're okay, what am I choosing?
Yeah, it was a pretty funny intersection. So basically, we just keep going to these moments. It was another moment. I was actually in a relationship with a guy for 5 years, all throughout college. I moved to New York for the Bloomberg job, and it was like something that my sexuality was something that I thought about, but it was kind of like, no, just, you know, you're in this relationship, you're happy, quiet, you know? And then you're fine. Yeah. Just kick the can down the road. So then I kind of like, I ended up, there was a night, actually, this is pretty funny. There was a night, Iowa is a, you know, a big political state. So I went to Iowa quite a bit. And there was a night before I went to Iowa that I was with my partner at the time, my boyfriend. And I just kind of thought to myself, like, later on that night, like, it was my moment of like saying it out loud to myself. It was like a growing voice. I was in New York. I was seeing queer couples all around me. And I started to like kind of feel this little bit of jealousy a bit, or like I would look at them and like feel something and I couldn't identify it. And then I kept like kind of putting this voice down. And then it was the night before I went to Iowa, and I thought to myself, like, you're, and it was a moment that I said it out, like out loud in my head. I say that like, you're gay. And the moment that I said that, it felt kind of like this flood of just like all of the wind taken out of me in this like really like weighty type of way where all of this weight was taken off of me. And it clicked the same way that I felt later on when I said, you don't want to be in journalism anymore, that you want to move to Tel Aviv. Like these, it was a similar type of feeling. And so I went to Iowa, and this all happened at like 2 a.m. So you can't really like wake up your boyfriend of 5 years and say like, hey, get up, I'm gay.
Yeah, well, you can.
You do it. So you can, but you know, it's that would have actually been better for the story looking back. But so I went to Iowa for 2 weeks and was just like in my head about it the whole time, being like, oh my gosh, how do I deal with this when I get back? Came back, we broke up, then I went to South Carolina for 2 weeks, and it just like it kind of became, it was actually kind of nice because I traveled so much, so I didn't feel like there was this transition of being gay, like go, like of transitioning to being gay in like my normal life. It was like I was coming to terms with it by myself on the road on my own and thinking about it, and then not like not having to talk about it with anyone if I didn't want to talk about it. Like I wasn't near my friends so much, was it didn't have the time to really talk to my family so much. So it really gave me a lot of time to just like be in myself and my own head in a way that I think really helped me process that.
Well, yeah. I want to dial back just a little bit, because you mentioned that you went to New York and you started seeing queer couples. You started experiencing people around you that were living, let's just say, on the surface, because we don't know any deeper, but we're out, they're doing whatever, you see them together, they're happy, all the things, right? And I want to mention this for the audience, is that it makes a difference when you can see yourself outside. And what I mean by that is my wife and I, Veronica, just went to Seattle, and we stayed in Capitol Hill, which is the gayborhood up there. And I... like when you're around those kind of people, you feel good. You feel like I can be here. I can hold my wife's hand. I, you know, one of the things we saw were trans people just out walking, smiling, all the things. And even gay, the LGBTQ plus community in my community, we don't do that. Like there's some dangers that are in my community where we don't feel safe enough to do that. And it's like, it makes a difference. It makes a difference when you see people who are like you. And that is why, one of the reasons why this Road to Radical Visibility podcast was even created, was because more people like you and I, the more we tell our stories, the more other people can say, I can be myself. I can be radically visible to myself as a person who is non-binary, transgender, any part of the LGBTQ plus community or other marginalized communities, right? I mean, it's so important.
Yeah, I mean, especially like, it's not, when I didn't come out for a bit, it's not because my, like, I'm very fortunate in the fact that my family has always been supportive, my friends have always been supportive, but I think that it was about, I think there's something in seeing, like seeing other people be so visible and feeling that and really letting that kind of sink in and listening to yourself while you see others be that way, that I think it wasn't that I didn't have queer examples. A lot of the people that I hung out with were queer. It wasn't like I was in a community that wouldn't have accepted me, because they did. It was just about the more that I saw these examples, the more that I saw even just random people just existing in themselves, that like that kind of thing is contagious. Like it's just, it's something that you're, it was enviable. It was really enviable to me.
Yeah. I have felt that same way in different parts of my career, in different parts of my life. And I don't know, this is the religious programming. I'm like, envy, you know, that's one of the Ten Commandments. Like, you're not supposed to envy or whatever. And it's like, it's so interesting what's happening in my brain. But it's like, yes, like I want that. And it's okay for me to want it. It doesn't, you know, it's okay for me to become who I am meant to be in this world. Right?
Exactly. Yeah.
It's a beautiful story.
Yeah. I mean, like when you're talking about also like visibility, like, and being able to be out, it also reminds me, like, last time that we were in New York, my wife and I would be walking around holding hands or something like that, where mm-hmm. we were comfortable doing that. And we kept joking about how there was like the New York smile is what we were calling it. Is that like as you're walking by, you have the queer people, but you also have the straight people, and they kind of smile at you as being like, I'm an ally. And you're like, yeah. So we're walking and we're noticing that all like she thought it was the weirdest thing in the world. But like all these people were just like, yeah. It's like kind of felt like that movie where you're like, where the guy's like walking into work and everyone's like, go get him, John. Like it was like this like weird vibe. So we're walking and everyone keeps smiling and we're laughing about it. And then we walked by Tina Fey. And she smiled at us.
And we're my gosh.
And I didn't even know, like, I didn't even really notice because, like, I didn't register to me. And then, like, my wife immediately noticed. She was so excited. And she looked at me and she's like, they gave us the New York smile. Like, such a moment. But it's like, this is all to say that I think that people also, even if they don't have that envy, they don't, like, it's about, like, that people like to see, like, it depends where you are, for sure. But there's at least in some places, there's this feeling that I think other people also like to see people living their truth. I mean, that's probably very optimistic of me to say. But in small parts of New York, there are places where people, I think that even if you are not queer yourself, there's like, I think that there is something, and I felt it when I wasn't identifying as queer, just feeling this excitement towards more people mm-hmm. being able to express who they are and be themselves, and mm-hmm. that happiness kind of hopefully being a bit contagious.
Well, happiness is contagious, and I can tell you radical visibility is contagious. And of course, the radical visibility definition is different for everyone. But for you, even just in this reflection and knowing in my own experiences that when we feel, as corny as it sounds, that we are loving ourselves, that we are accepting every part of ourselves, that we are knowing ourselves and remove that judgment and shame, you create a different energy from internally inside of you. And therefore, other people, your New York smile, people will be like, and you're like, I don't know what it is. I'm still the same person, but you've opened up and become more expansive to yourself and loving towards yourself by allowing yourself to be radically visible to you. And it shows, the energy transfers to other people. Absolutely. Without a doubt.
Yeah. And this is also, it's not even just like the happiness of it. I think that what's also important is that I think a really important, like, key part of radical visibility is also about being just as visible to yourself when you're saying you're not happy, or just as visible to yourself when you're saying this doesn't feel right, or like that helps you get to that happiness. But it's, there really is so much power. And also I think that it's really hard, especially with social media, especially as we kind of compare ourselves to other people, especially as you're seeing, now you see the person you went to high school with and what they're doing for work now. And like you jump to all of these conclusions and opinions. Mm-hmm. And I think that there is a really powerful thing. And most of my big life changes were actually spurred from admitting when I was unhappy. Mm-hmm. And I think that that part, there's like this expectation. I'm a really extroverted person. My old boss used to say that like my kind of like resting bitch face was like a smile. Like I just would like, if I'm just sitting there, I'll just be like smiling to myself. It's like, it's a vibe. And so there's, I think that like for some people, yeah, it's really been proven to be true. And for some people, it's like, it's this feeling of like, to me, admitting that I'm unhappy is hard. It gets really difficult. And so, and it's something that I have to come to myself in. All of these decisions, mm-hmm. when I talk about coming out, when I talk about moving, when I talk about just like anything, it's all quitting my job. They were all decisions that I made in my, like, I didn't discuss with anybody, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. not decisions. Like, they were all life steps that I came to without discussing with anyone, because I knew that I needed to process it in my own head. And I think mm-hmm. part of that was because I felt a sense of unhappiness and I had mm-hmm. a problem sharing that with other people.
Well, I think it's one thing too that so many people struggle with, that I help in particular, is that being able to know what they want, what their path is without all the input, the external input, right? In the online world, as you well know, you can find anything on a Google search. You can have access to thousands, millions, billions of videos on YouTube. Like, you can find everything outside of yourself, but the key is finding everything within yourself and knowing what that looks like for you, knowing what anxiety means for you, like knowing how, knowing what you want to do about something and what is that process that you can lead yourself through to know your answer and really be tuned in with yourself enough to know the answer and then to follow that, right? Because that's when something breaks free.
Yeah. I think also I just, like, sometimes it's hard to know what's happening in yourself when you're mm-hmm. kind of looking at all of these other people. I always joke mm-hmm. that I feel like there's like some sort of, at least for me, there was a difficulty when I was coming out, as I was thinking, like, I was talking about it with a friend of a male friend of mine who I'd also identifies as gay, and he was saying that he was like, I feel like it's sometimes a little bit more difficult for lesbians, for women to come out, because there's this like societal type of thing about like women appreciating other women's beauty, mm. you know, like women more mm. openly will talk about like, oh, that woman's hot, that woman's attractive, where like mm-hmm. men aren't doing that as much. So I think usually, like, I'm speaking generally, but mm-hmm. I think that there was a moment where I kind of was like, oh, well, I don't feel this way. We all feel this way. Like, we all love women, you know, like I was mm-hmm. so relying on what other people were saying that then I was kind of like, No, this isn't what you're feeling. You're confused because, like, mm. your friends are straight and they also think that Kendall Jenner's beautiful, you know? But, mm-hmm. like, that yeah. one just popped into my head. But,
yeah, like, I love
it's
it.
It's just this, like, this, and I was, like, kind of, I had this distrust of my own gut because I was seeing what other people were saying. So I think that those kinds of, like, that's why I also, like, to bring it back to the first question, it's about kind of being radically visible to yourself. It's also yeah. about drown, like, taking away what all these other people think and really just sitting with yourself and saying, where yeah. am I at right now? Don't mm-hmm. compare it to what your friends are saying mm-hmm. or what other people are saying. Like, where are you? So. Mm-hmm.
Well, so now we're going to come out to this. Now you're a community manager for Riverside.fm. It's mm-hmm. how we met. You are, I mean, like, just from our discussions and our exploration of getting to know each other, you know, it seems like it is such a great fit for you. What Thank are you. You hoping that you're going to be able to do in this role?
Oh, so
this was not a planned question, everyone. This is off the cuff.
what do I plan it? I mean, for, like, I think that part of, like, I love connecting with people and I want to help people kind of, like, I want to help people in what they're creating. I've always been a really creative person. Mm-hmm. And I think that first for me, the reason that kind of attracted me to the job, besides loving the idea of bringing communities, like, of bringing people's stories together and understanding mm-hmm. and talking with people, is that I really needed, like, I really wanted a creative outlet and to be able to talk with other creators. Mm-hmm. And I think that really one of the beautiful things about this community is that I'm coming from journalism. So journalism's a lot about, like, you keep your sources and your information close, and you're not going to tell somebody how to be a better yep. journalist as much, because that's your value in a way. Mm-hmm. Like, it's all about how, whose sources you, what sources you have, everything. And I think that what was surprising to me about the podcasting community is that people were so open to share and make, like, to, in order to help other people become better. This is my social media strategy. This is what I do to make my recordings better, that type of thing. And so I've really, after talking with community members, in the beginning, I was like, oh, people want to connect. They want to network. But then when I realized that people want to connect and network to make themselves better. So my big goal with the community is to kind of, is to help people share stories in the, like, because I think that that's just the most beautiful thing that you can do. I think that, so
yes,
whether that's making them more in high quality, maybe that's making the, like, getting, helping people get different guests. Maybe that's about helping them get their, expand their reach for their show. I think that my main goal is to really just help people with their creative passion. And I think that that's, it's been really rewarding so far to just see that. And I know that sounds very much like this kind of like, I wanna, you know, it's very like, what's your weakness? I care too much. But it really is like, I think that that's what drives me. There are some days where I'll get frustrated with things, then I'll have a call with a user, and it just like completely, like our call, completely just like turned my day around. And I'm like, I'm so excited that I get to meet all these people and then help them do what they're passionate about. Because for a lot of the people in the community, I mean, there are a lot of full-time podcasters, but there are a lot of people that are side hustling with this. And it's just like, I think that it's so like exciting and inspiring. So I kind of want to keep it going.
I love that. And I'm so glad that you're the community manager and part of this Riverside.fm community. I've loved Riverside from the moment I started using it, and it does make things easier. It makes things more streamlined for my podcast. It makes it for me to be able, just like you, you know, me connecting with people, me helping people tell their stories, me putting it out there so that people in the world can feel better and be become radically visible and be 100% themselves, because the world is a better place when people do that, right? And the diversity is what makes this stuff rich. And the podcast where it reaches so many more people makes the world a richer place to live, a more beautiful, experiential place to have a life, right? And I just love that.
Yeah, and that's like the thing that I really love about Riverside too, is that it, like, you can, like, I'm talking from my office, you're talking, like, it's just, like, it makes it accessible. Like, I don't, like, when you limit how you can create high quality things, like recordings, things like that, it's like, it limits the stories that are told. And so when you're able to bring it to somebody's living room, to somebody's office, somebody's bedroom, like, when you're able to make these kinds of things more accessible, these kinds of platforms, then you're able to provide a platform for more people, you're able to get more stories out there. And I just, like, selfishly, I just really love listening to podcasts too. And like, the more quality things that are out there, the more stories that I can listen to, you know, the better.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I feel like this episode has so many golden nuggets, beautiful moments in it. If you've been listening and or watching the video on the YouTube channel and you've had something that you can resonate with, that you've had something that you're like, oh my gosh, me too, I've felt that before, or I want more of that, please make sure to leave a comment below. Also reach out to me, and I can also put you in touch with Kendall. I'll make sure to forward any messages that you guys have of how this podcast and episode has impacted you. Is there anything else you want to add really quick before we wrap this up?
Yeah, just anyone's welcome to reach out to me. I would love to have a conversation if you related to this podcast, but also even if you're thinking of starting a podcast, like, I love meeting people. I love talking about it. So I think open it up to more people and get some more stories out there. So always open to talk about anything I talked about on here, or just podcasting in general, because I'd love to discuss.
Awesome. So let people know how they can reach out to you.
So I am basically on, like, I'm on Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram. You can message, all my profiles are public, I believe. And you can just reach out, search me by Kendall Brightman. I won't go ahead and spell it here. You could see it in the show.
Yeah, but I'll put it all in the show notes.
Reach out to me on any social media. Yeah, perfect.
Fantastic.
And any form of social media, I'm on it all the time,
Yeah, it's
unfortunately.
part of what we do, right? Okay, my friends, I hope you all enjoyed this episode. I'm going to end it like I end every single episode. Please make sure to stay true to yourself, be kind to others, and always, always, always honor the wise one that is within you. I will see you all on the next Road to Radical Visibility. Until then, bye. Hold up, don't go yet. If this episode inspired you to be 100% yourself 100% of the time, no shame or guilt needed, even just that little bit more, I would love to hear from you in the comments below. I'm here, and I know you are too, to make a positive impact in the world. So don't forget to share the love. And if you were left wanting more of this type of kick-ass content, then don't forget to click the like and subscribe button. Until next time, make sure to stay true and be you. Until then, bye.